How many of you have heard of Lucia Lucas? Okay, very good. So, what's really cool, let's see if I can escape this now that you've had a chance to hear her sing. I'll go back to current slide. So she is going to be featured in Tulsa Opera's 2018-2019 season, first transgender person at all to have a leading role. That'll be in May 2019. Pretty cool, I thought. So yeah, I was kind of like, maybe I can take a trip down to Omaha. Yeah. Or Oklahoma. Wait, where is Tulsa? Yes. Yeah, Oklahoma. but pretty amazing, and an amazing voice. I love that. So here is our presentation, Nurturing the Voice, Techniques and Exercises to Guide the Voice Through a Healthy Transition. I have some handouts that I printed, so I'm just going to pass them out, and you can take them. I'll let Anita get herself started. I think this goes right to you.
All right. Okay, so did you want us to switch microphones just while...
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
Okay.
Should I stand closer to her?
Okay. Okay.
Great.
Yeah, don't worry.
That's okay.
Thanks.
Okay, well, I first saw somebody work with a person who was trans in 1973, and that piqued my interest, and I've been pursuing the knowledge and the opportunities to understand more and do more work ever since. So it's been quite a wonderful journey. And there is a book that some of you may be familiar with, Voice and Communication Therapy for the Transgender Transsexual Client. This is the second edition. And the third edition we will be hopefully seeing available in late summer, early fall. I wrote the chapter on the singing voice, and in all three editions, and I'm fortunate to have Sandy Hammond, who was the founder and conductor of the Boston Butterfly Transgender Chorus. She wrote a section about choral work in the new edition. So I am pleased to let you know that that'll be coming out. And then I've worked as a singer, songwriter. I am still doing that, alto sax, keyboards, and I don't know where our little clicker thing is to dance it. That's okay. And I am grateful that in my professional association, I'm a speech and language pathologist, that they have recognized the importance of helping people who are trans, who want work, whether transfeminine or transmasculine, to speak the best they can, use their voice in the healthiest manner, and to sing as well. And so in 2009, I was one of the people recognized with the Diversity Champions Award. And that same year, Lavender Magazine recognized my work in this community of Minneapolis and St. Paul. I also have co-hosted a Bi-Cities cable TV show, which is interviews with people, all who have something to say of interest to the GLBT community. So that was also mentioned. And then I have a CD of voice exercises that both trans and cisgender people have found very helpful. And I do sell that. That would be the one thing I'd have to say, yes, do I have any potential for a monetary advantage. And then I've presented at WPATH, which is the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, and the US version, and the American Speech and Hearing Association, and then other places. Thank you, Reed, for about voice in general, about singing voice, and about for people who are transgender. Both male, I first presented about the female speaking voice and singing voice, and have presented as well about women. So I think the next slides are you're going to be introducing yourself. So.
Well, that's not good. Let's see here. Huh. Oh dear, my slides aren't there.
No.
Huh. Well, that's interesting.
We know you exist. You're not invisible.
I know. If you guys don't, you all don't mind. Apologize.
So if we just go over on the left bar and click on it, will that work?
I almost wonder if I might actually have it on a different flash drive. Apologize, guys. No. I'm so excited, I got nervous, and then I probably put in the wrong one. Just not to lose time, my name is Lisa Butcher. I am a speech-language pathologist. I work at the Lion's Voice Clinic, which is part of the University of Minnesota. And I'm truly honored to be here today. I'm so excited. I kind of feel like I'm sure what a lot of the students and the coachings were feeling this morning, talking more. I think this might be the one. Yay! Okay. In the current slide. Ha ha! Did I say I was a soprano? Technology is hard. So I work at the Lion's Voice Clinic, and we are interested in education, research, outreach, everything that we can do to talk about the voice. We love all things voice. And I have three colleagues with me. I couldn't find our group photo. So you see us last year for World Voice Day. And by the way, if you don't know, World Voice Day is Monday. It's April 16th every year. Anita's going to come and she's going to sing with us. And I have two colleagues on the speech team, Dan Weinstein and Dr. Deidre Michael, or Dee Dee. And Dan and I are heading up the transgender voice work that we're doing with clients at the clinic. We also have two laryngologists, Dr. George, or Shep Godding, and Dr. Stephanie Masono, and they are also doing a lot of work. Stephanie's work is wonderful for understanding distress and the voice, and she's doing a lot of research in that, and I really have been able to participate in the collection of some of that data, and it's fascinating work. About 2 years ago, we moved to the Clinics and Surgery Center, which is located just off of Huron Boulevard, so very close to the campus. And to tell you a little bit about myself, I have bachelor's degrees in music, so I went to Eau Claire for that. Got my master's in music at Austin Peay State University, which is a very small university in Clarksville, Tennessee. Like the monkey song, take the last train. when I finished that, I had had the fortunate opportunity of being exposed to the Vanderbilt Voice Clinic and Center, and I loved the idea of helping injured voices get back to where they wanted to be. And so I came here to the University of Minnesota. I got my second master's in speech-language pathology. And during that time, I spent some time with the National Center for Voice and Speech, learning from Dr. Ingo Tietze from the Summer Vocology Institute. And I did complete that, so I have a certificate in vocology. And then I've continued for probably 12 seasons now, singing with the Minnesota Opera. And we just finished, I was in Dumpasquale, and it was kind of fun. I was Carmen Miranda with fruit on my head. And then we did Dead Man Walking, and that was really thought-provoking and great piece. At the Lions, or the Clinics and Surgery Center, we are now just launching something very exciting. We have the Comprehensive Gender Care Team. And so that doesn't just involve Dan and myself. We have psychologists on staff that we're now collaborating with. We have family medicine. We have endocrinologists. And we have the only two in the metro area plastic surgeons that are doing procedures for those who need it. So that's pretty cool. We have a care coordinator who is wonderful and has been helping to connect our patients to all the services that they may wish to pursue. And that is very, very exciting. So it's wonderful to have him. So I have a few considerations here. I've put more things on my do's and don'ts handout that I kind of put together. I don't know if Eli is, I don't think he's here, but I already apologized to him and I know I spelled his name wrong, so I apologize for that again. But I wanted to remind us that the singer truly leads these lessons. This is their voice. We are here to kind of guide that change. But I'm sure if you were one of the people I worked with this morning, you know that I always started with, what do you want to work on? Where are you at with your voice? And I think that's a nice place to start. Working with this population is not new necessarily, but it's really exciting that more and more people can live their authentic life. And we want to support that. And so we're probably going to be seeing more. And we just need to trust our guts as voice teachers, for those of you who do teach voice, and kind of go with our gut. And along the way, it's okay to say, I'm not sure. I think there's a lot of voice teachers I've had where they've kind of wanted to be the authority on everything. And I don't think that works at all. It needs to be a back and forth, you know? I don't think that we can just go, well, I studied with this person who learned from this person who, that's all good, but this is a whole new thing, right? In some ways. We should not be the authority on all aspects of somebody who's transitioning. It takes a village, and we should refer to that village. And so if a voice teacher is starting to work with someone who's new and maybe transitioning, I believe that should involve good communication. Are they working with a speech-language pathologist? Can we talk about that? Can we talk to each other? Can we get together? How can we make the best voice for this person, whatever they're looking for? We should have those kind of discussions. And that takes time, but I think it's worth it. Private information needs to stay private. I don't know how many of you encounter, we're gregarious, we're loud, a lot of us are extroverted musicians, and so we need to keep things private, not accidentally out people. We know the statistics, we've even seen it, and I love this wonderful program for this weekend, how there's so much information just on the percentages of bullying, suicidal thoughts, things like that, that we want to be allies, fierce allies, and try to promote a healthy growth for that person. So respiratory mechanics. I put in some things, extra things that I've been learning that I thought might be helpful, and I hope I'm not completely preaching to the choir, but students may have varying degrees of gender dysphoria. We need to appreciate that. I don't like talking about just like feel your belly or hands on belly and chest. Maybe that's not comfortable. Maybe that brings up feelings that will tense that person up, not allow them to breathe. So I like the idea of maybe doing a body scan and just kind of noticing areas of tension, mentioning the shoulders, the rib cage, throat, eyes instead. Anita, by the way, on her CD, has a great relaxation body scan that is really good. Some other ideas for what we can do. And by the way, I really love, I was just at the Transgender Voice and Communication Conference last week that was in Chicago. That was with Sandy Hirsch, Christy Block, and Leah Halu. I'm not sure if you're familiar with any of those names, but they're wonderful, wonderful people in the speech-language pathology world who are and have been working with this population for a long time. Leah talked about metatherapy, and so I'm trying to put in exercises to give you ideas. Maybe there are things you're already doing, but I thought let's have some ideas here. So I used this one a lot today because those practice rooms are kind of small. Just bending forward, elbows on the knees. Can we feel that rib cage expand and contract? Can we notice what's happening down here? Okay, now can we keep it there? And how do we use that? Or maybe we're even kind of leaning over a yoga ball and then feeling an expansion that way. as you breathe. Finding that breath is so important. I mentioned multiple times today the that kind of deer in headlights thing is a real experience. And if we're stressed, we're going to kind of close off. We're not going to be able to access that breath. I'm sure every one of us has had a very traumatic time in our lives where it's been hard to find our breath. And so I think it's wonderful to come into a space, come into your voice lesson, whatever's happened out there, we can use that moment to breathe and maybe let go of some of that. And then we can make some change. Some other things to keep in mind. This was a little bit newer to me, and so I thought it was worthwhile to point out that some of our trans men, gender fluid, non-binary singers might bind or chest bind. And so to keep in mind for the music teacher, it's not appropriate to say, take that off. No, it's like asking somebody to walk around without their underwear and saying, that would be uncomfortable and weird and odd. maybe we could ask them to work on their breath at home if we felt that was really needed. But I don't necessarily think it should be needed. There's a lot of times, even as a singer myself, where I've had to be bound into some kind of contraption to sing on stage in a big ball gown or whatever they're asking us to sing in. We can still find our breath. Maybe it shouldn't be a full body, low one. Can we have one that's a little shorter? And then maybe it's also helpful to know how many hours a day is that person in that? So we just get a sense of maybe overall, over the whole course of the day, how is their breath? And then maybe we need to look into that as well. That could change patterns for singing later on in the day. These were great exercises that Christy Block pointed out too, for those that bind, doing just a cat stretch. Want to stretch with me if you want to stand up. Just do palms out and you're just kind of leaning forward. And you could even breathe into that and out. A little stretch that way. We could do a clavicle stretch and just kind of dig into that clavicle bone. Just kind of work around with our fingers and just kind of pull down and around. This one was kind of tickly for me. Just kind of pulling under the rib cage and stretching things out too. Taking our thumbs, she kind of modified this one from Frances Reed and kind of digging in to the armpits a little bit, stretching that out. Again, these are things that anybody could benefit from. How many hours a day are we typing on a computer or driving in a car? This area gets tight, it gets tense. Thank you for having a time with me. To think about singers that maybe are going through the process of facial feminization surgery, maybe we can work on the face a little bit, raising the eyebrows, playing with different emotional faces, crunching up the nose and the teeth, moving the lips and the face around. So warm-ups, as we pointed out by showing you Lucia earlier on, not all transfeminine singers decide they want to modify their voices. She's doing wonderful, and I love that she is just very proud of being this wonderful baritone voice, and it's working for her. However, others may experience some vocal dysphoria. They might not want to explore that low range anymore. Again, we have to let the singer lead. I like to start with semi-occluded vocal tract exercises. Some of you already got to experience that. I had everybody get a straw. And of course, I have no idea where my straw is. So how many of you have played with straws before? Wonderful. Oh, good. Oh, no, I'm getting one face like, wait, I've never seen that before. So Dr. Ingo Tietze, known as the father of vocology, has done a lot of research into the mechanics of our voice. And he has talked about, thank you, these exercises that we can do semi-occluded or partly blocked in the front of the mouth, vocal tract exercises. So what we're doing is we're creating more pressure towards the front of the face. Basically, it helps to unload any extra tension that we have down here at the level of the vocal folds, and it gives a nice balance to them. I love working with the straw. I actually really also like working with the straw in about an inch or two of water. It just gives a nice resistance. You can get a sense of how you're connecting your breath to your sound. But take a breath for me now, and can you give me a nice comfortable whoo on a pitch that's comfortable for you? Notice that nice buzzy sensation towards the front of your face. Give me a little glide. We could do these glides on specific intervals if we want, or we could do just sometimes what I call them our gentle hills, like we just did, gliding up and down. I also like to do a little bit of messa de voce work. So we're working all three dimensions of our vocal folds, right where they do their dance. We lengthen and shorten them as we glide up and down, and then a messa de voce is soft to loud to soft. So the tippy toe edges touch, we're increasing that medial compression, and then we're backing off of that. So let's try that, or I'll show you what I mean if you've never done that before. Okay, so it's kind of like the lawnmower coming in front of your bedroom window. If that's too difficult to stay on a single pitch, I always want it to be comfortable. So maybe you could do the spooky ghost. Want to give one of those a try? Play with that for a second. Yeah, so I know what all of you will be doing, hiding behind the bushes at your house for Halloween. We can also use this as a great way to vocalize and move up and down by half steps. So going back to the glides, you could use it for that too. So I already kind of explained that. What's kind of neat is I was actually there in the summer of 2006. So it's fun when you're a part of something you don't realize is going to be a big deal. The big part about this slide that I wanted to show you is the YouTube videos. So if you've not seen Dr. Tietze, if you just YouTube search it, Dr. Tietze and Straws, he's got a variety of exercises or videos on there. And then I also really like Tom Berkey. He has a YouTube video you won't forget, Straws Will Save Your Life. And he uses the water like what I like to do. So you can watch him do it and see if you like that way. Give it a try when you leave here today. It's really fun. Straws Will Save Your Life. So in the chapter that Anita has written in the only book available to speech and language pathologists right now, so amazing, I'm so excited to be here presenting with her. She has some exercises that are nice, and I've modified them just a little bit. So we could do her first one that she notes, which is just using H and vowels, and you could just do kind of a descending. Can I?
Sure.
Would you mind?
Not
Thank
at all.
You. So if I live here, maybe, actually let's say middle C, because that's easy and I'm nervous. We can work that high and low and around. We could also do some sentences, H, W, H. So I have hamburger helper, or we could do hunt on the hill, Helga has horses. Why, oh, why? And just a nice, fun way to, again, warm up the speaking voice. I don't think that's addressed enough with music teachers, and I don't blame them because it's just not something that we've studied. I'm really thankful that oftentimes voice teachers will refer to us at the Lions Voice Clinic when there is a speaking voice problem. And again, we want to be a part of that team with all of our singers. So we want to connect with the music teachers and, again, help guide the singer. These are great exercises, too, to just warm up your day. Are you a professional speaker? Do you teach people? We should be warming our voice up as we're walking to work, as we're in the car, in between when you take a break to run to the restroom. You should be warming up and using these as a nice cool down. So right now there isn't a lot of research for pitch norms for singing, range for transgender and non-binary singers. But my thought currently is for singers, we can use classification of vocal registers that we know from resources like Clifton Wares, if you're familiar with him. He's a professor from the university. His Basics of Pedagogy book, he has some nice, well-organized spaces or ranges for bass, baritone, tenor, alto, mezzo-soprano. Christy Block was noting over last weekend for cis women, the averages just for the speaking voice, just to give us an idea of where do these voices live, is approximately around G flat 3 to B flat 3. For trans women, it might be E flat 3 to G flat 3. For cis men, they live around A flat 2 to C 3. I did see, which was really cool, I haven't gotten a chance to read the whole thing because I literally just got it, but this wonderful book from Matthew Mills and Gilly Stoneham, and they also noted that gender-neutral starting pitches for the speaking voice tend to be between D3 and A3. And since I'm going to be talking about the transfeminine voice, they had a typical female identified range of for speech as C3 to E4. C3, in my mind, I was kind of surprised to see because I think tenor, that's low. Yeah. But it's how we use the voice, right? And how we approach our breath, where's the timbre, how's the resonance. So I thought that was interesting to kind of point out and to keep that in mind, because so many of our students want to be perfect. They want to get it right. They want to have, I had somebody come in just recently, she just wanted to make sure she was hitting C4. She just wanted middle C, and I thought, that's kind of high. But, you know, so I think it's helpful to have an idea and say, it's okay to work in this. If it makes them uncomfortable, then we're not going to go there. But I think it was nice to see that those ranges are actually a lot wider than I thought. Maybe that information will change next year. Maybe we'll learn more. A new research study will come out. I'm hoping to do more in that field myself. So maybe we'll have more norms more accurate norms as things progress. So with the transfeminine voice, things to keep in mind, we should regularly check in. I like to ask people often, how does that feel? Does it feel easy? Did you notice your breath? Where's your tongue? All those things that I get harped on all the time from my own voice teacher. it's also important to encourage open communication again. For those who decide to pursue medications, endocrinologists have a long-standing knowledge of how antiandrogens work. If you want to know what those are and you can pronounce that, good. I can. Very good. Very good. and how they change the body from other populations in the past. And so it's important to note that at least for these anti-androgens, they do not generally change the quality of the voice. They're not going to raise pitch up. And I think that's important to remember. Christy at the conference also noted that it's important to maybe know some maybe non-medical treatments that our singers might be doing. For example, maybe it isn't the best idea to do an electrolysis treatment to your face and come in like a red tomato to a voice lesson, and you don't necessarily want to move your mouth or your jaw around. I thought that was actually a really good idea. I can't think of any others, but anybody, if you think of another one, let me know. And then I love Eli Conley's blog, and so I put in some of those questions to make our new student intake a little bit more inclusive. What are questions that we should be asking? How can we frame them so that we're not sounding completely inappropriate when we're asking questions? There is a wonderful, if you haven't, have you all heard of Emerald Leslie? Mm-hmm. Okay, so Emerald, I think she's in Germany right now. I need to say hi to her at some point in time. I've never met her, but this just came out, her dissertation from just last year, University of Washington, Teaching Transgender Singers. And I just found it free. It's online. You can find it yourself. You're welcome to come up and take a closer look at this. What's great is she talks a little bit more about those medications. She talks to the transmasculine and transfeminine voice and puts it in a really nice, clear way. I also really love that she has resources towards the back that talk about maybe different repertoire choices, which I thought was really helpful. Her mentor has something that she addresses vocal teaching by, which is called the five systems of voice: respiration, phonation, registration, articulation, and resonance. And I kind of liked that idea from my own pedagogy training and how I sometimes approach my patients in clinic. So with that in mind, we've already talked and addressed the phonation part. We've talked about semi-occluded vocal tract exercises and the glides. And now moving into resonation, one of the ideas that I played with some of the students today was the idea of chiaroscuro, so that light and darkness, yeah. And so we could use a nice bright vowel and we could combine that with a dark vowel just to kind of find where's that sweet spot in the voice. So we could do that with just a, even just a chant. So if I may, I'll pick my A. Just starting on that modal pitch, you know, just kind of playing with that. We could take that into small intervals of a second or third and move up gradually. We could take that just stepwise, which I did with someone today, and that was really great also for his ear training, and I thought that was really helpful. We can combine that with registration, isolation if we want, and we could identify the passaggio and then work into the head voice. If we would like to kind of start there, we could work below in the chest voice. I think it's really important to also work through that passaggio transition, again, making sure there's a good balance for the whole range. Here's an exercise that I kind of was thinking about as I was talking with Anita on Monday. I'm just kind of doing a, if you don't mind. Thank you. So what did I do here? Nia, or you could do a more advanced Nia. Try not to prolong notes, just kind of gliding, keeping it easy. Whatever level though that they're at, I of course want to respect that, and so maybe that means we need to start with smaller intervals. If there's any vocal fatigue, we can move back towards that modal range. I like playing with twang a lot, and so kind of finding that forward bright. I was describing it to the students today as, give me a little wah, 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 wah. Wah. Yeah, I want to hear everybody wah.
Wah.
Wah. Oh, thank you. Beautiful. So finding that nice forward resonant place just with our own speaking voice, I think is so important. And that's often where I see all of the singers get kind of tripped up. I think we get into this classical place where we must sound like this all the time. And if we can just kind of bring it a little bit more forward, it feels easier, it sounds nice. And not that we're gonna talk like this all the time, but let's go to that extreme, play with the voice, right? Articulation and resonance. Resonant phonemes and vowels I also really like to work with. Just again, to do something like a hung is great to get the tongue out of the way. So maybe we're just right? We can kind of play and find that forward resonant focus. And again, if we've got some tongue-based tension, we can get that out of our way. Thinking clear, articulation is also attributed to a more feminine sound, so if we need to work on that, I will sometimes address that too. All right, that's my part. We will have time for questions. Did I do okay?
You did great.
Okay, so we'll take a little time out. I'm gonna give her this mic. Thank you for your patience. Thank you.
You got a belt. You want to hang it on the back like hers?
Well, if it'll work.
Well, no, I mean, do you have a belt line?
Do I have a belt?
Well, a belt line.
Like a waistband.
Yeah, waistband.
Yeah, on this one.
Yeah, let's do that.
All right.
So.
Maybe I'll let you do that, wherever's comfortable.
Okay. Well, yeah, let's do this. And so. Ooh, I think that's it.
I'm just gonna bring your, there you go.
Thanks.
And if you don't mind it trailing around, we could just leave it out like that.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay, that'll make it easier and we can get right back to the presentation.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
True Minnesotan, I say you bet. You bet. I'm a left-hander and I.
I'm happy to do this.
Would you? Would you? That'd be great. That'd be great. Thank you.
We're actually both left-handed, which is.
And I was like, I always want everything to my left, you know, so. And you know, I didn't tell you that I am here in Minneapolis and St. Paul. I have the Kozan Clinic for Voice, Speech, and Spirit, which is my very comfortable living room, and mirrors and some things, but piano, different keyboards. But anyway, worked in medical settings most of my career. But I'm very happy to be seeing people privately now. All right. So this is a quote that from those, I think there are a few people here who were at the Voice Singing Voice Conference in 2004. It says, some T-men really want to have a beard. Others want the change in the shape of their body. And some men really want a deep voice. You take testosterone and then you see what happens. Sometimes you get what you want, but sometimes you don't. And that was in a support group that I, thanks very much, that I had the privilege of sitting in on. And I think that whole thing of what's going to happen to my voice, what's going to happen to all of me, it is a big deal to figure it out. And so in the chapter on the singing voice, in the book and in the third edition that's coming out, there are, you know, ideas for both transfeminine and transmasculine, as well as this in this edition, non-binary speakers who and singers who want to make the best of their voice abilities. Okay, so trans men have been seen for speaking and or singing voice therapy because of overdriving the voice due to speaking or singing at too low a pitch, speaking at too loud a voice volume, using increased vocal tension, pushing to produce a more clear voice. And that's in the medical setting when I saw people with injured voices, that was really the biggest problem. And Lisa and I are both big fans of singing vocalises as well as speaking voice exercises, warm-ups and cool-downs. And that is how I helped a number of men be able to not have the problems with vocal fatigue that they had been having, be able to have a more a clearer sounding voice, a more handsome voice, and to reduce the stress that they felt from speaking. And so, you know, any number of men told me, well, you know, I want to push on those chords, you know, I really want that voice to come out. And unfortunately, it's just the wrong thing to do. When we are essentially training or conditioning muscles that have never spoken in this range before, we have to do it very carefully. Just like I know that at least one of you is a very well-conditioned runner, but we cannot be looking at running a long distance, which is essentially what we'd be asking our vocal folds to do, to talk really loudly, to talk really low when the vocal folds had never done that before. So it's really a huge amount of work. And I say that speaking is an athletic event. For those of you who are musicians, you know, at middle C, C4 on the piano, would you just plunk that for me, please? Thanks. So that's middle C. In 1 second, our vocal folds blow apart and come back together 256 times. Now that's amazing. An octave higher for the people who can sing C5, you multiply by two,
512 openings and closings in a second. And as you go down the scale, you divide by two, so middle C is 256, C below middle C, C3, divide by two, 128 openings and closings. So it truly is a lot of work to be taking good care of ourselves in so many ways. You know, we think about mind, body, spirit, but specifically for the voice, it's a huge challenge to condition our voices in a very careful manner. Okay, so I can't talk about the seminal work in care of the transmasculine voice, particularly the transmasculine singing voice, without talking about Dr. Alexandros Constantzis. Alexandros is from Athens, but did his doctoral work in York, in the UK, and there's a whole bunch of citations there for him. But what I want you to know about him is that this is the man who was the first one, and he was his own pilot subject. He studied using a lower dose of testosterone and doing what we call titration of the changes in the amounts, doing a very slow titration of bringing up the amount of testosterone very slowly, very carefully, in hopes of preserving his singing voice. He was a classically trained singer, performed in his female gender assigned at birth, and wanted to be very careful and see what he could preserve. So he did breathing exercises, lip trill, some of the kind of the classic speech things that we do, and very careful vocalises, and studied himself over a period of, I know it was at least 6 months, I think it might have been a year. And then did his doctoral work studying a group of men, half of whom did the more traditional high dosage boom right out of the block, and the other group who did slow and low to begin with. And he studied the ranges of the voice that they were able to achieve. And what he found was that the men who started with a lower dosage and built up gradually had a wider singing range, had more notes available them to sing than did the men who started right away. And this was with a high dosage. And this was done in the mid-aughts, I think 2002, 2007, 8, around in there. And at the time, in England, it was very bad for you to be, you know, if you were a man, you were gonna take that testosterone and take the big dosage. And there were people who were upset with him for wanting, you know, for wanting to do it differently. And he was just insistent. And he saw that the men who chose to do it more carefully had a better outcome. Now, I thought the interesting thing about his research also showed, though, that the younger men, the men in their 20s, had more notes in their range than did the men in their 50s. And it was very, you know, it was very stepwise in terms of the men in their 20s had the most notes, men in their 30s had just one less, 40s had a little less. I mean, but every group, the men who took did the lower, slower dosage route had a wider range.
Is that because, or maybe you don't know, of the ossification of the cartilage in the larynx?
Well, you know, all of
a person gets older, it ossifies.
Right, but it's pretty much ossified by age 30.
Okay.
So, I have wondered that myself. I mean, there are other changes that happen with aging, and that's kind of not our topic today. But I would think that especially in the 20s, I mean, we come out of our teens going into the 20s, our vocal folds overall are just more flexible. You know, we might get vocal nodules accidentally, of course, but be able to get get them to resolve much more quickly than as we get into the higher 20s, 30s, 40s. So Alexandros said, that he really wants you to know that if you read his research, and I would encourage it just because I think it's really interesting, but he said that don't use the same products that he used then, because that was all that he could get in the UK, and he had to work hard to find a physician who would prescribe what he took. He said, go with your endocrinologist or whomever you are working with to choose the best products and then figure out how you want to take it on. I'm going to just say one more thing and then I'll take your question. Also, he said that, I'm sorry, I started thinking about you and I forgot what I was going to say. So, well,
shouldn't have raised my hand.
No.
Is that something you think is worth mentioning in an endocrinology, like an endocrinologist appointment? Like,
absolutely.
Like,
you're a singer. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Like, and you ask for that. Absolutely.
The lower dose.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Good. And it comes and goes. I remembered it and then it went again. So it'll come back. The joys of aging, So, pardon me?
I was gonna.
Yeah, I think you can go ahead. Thanks. Okay, so, okay, I think, yeah, all right. Singers and speakers describe this full sensation, like there's something in their throat, or they have like a covered feeling.
This is during change,
mm-hmm.
during
or post change too. Okay. That he was the first one to describe what we call entrapment, or that the vocal folds are entrapped because our larynx is going to stay the same size. This structure here, and the vocal folds are very tiny, like in cis women, 3/4 of an inch to an inch, cis men, 1 to 1.25 inches. But with testosterone, they get fuller, so you get this lower pitched voice. But you still have the same shaped cartilages that are housing the vocal folds. And so men would have talked to me for years that, I feel like, I don't know, like there's something over it. And so I even think of the covered sound kind of thing, the feeling of something being covered.
Do you think that's the false vocal folds?
No. Nope, the false vocal folds, good question though. The false vocal folds are above and to the side. Now that could certainly contribute to the sense of thickness because I would expect that they would be enlarged just like the true folds would. But they stay off to the side of the true folds all the time, except if we're like coughing or something like that. But it would take up a little more space. But I think it is just that we've got a bigger structure in the same space of area in which we vocalize. So, okay. So again, I throw incense at the shrine. Alexandros Konstantzis was the person who first thought about this, talked about this. Okay. Okay, so best practices for trans men. Konstantzis says, and you can read it and I'll say it in a minute. And I like this, and I have to credit Lisa for mentioning this from whoever said this in Chicago, that when we do a more gradual onset of testosterone, it is more like a cis male experience. And so that makes sense that maybe we would have a little better outcome. Certainly I've worked with cis men where things didn't go right when they were going through puberty and I had to help them find their true voice. But the other thing I did want to mention is certainly there are plenty of men who took testosterone and did the high dosage right away and whose voices came out fine. So, it's not like, for sure, this is going to happen to you if you don't do it my way. No, but I just want you to know that most singers, even to the point of choosing not to transition with any medication because they want to protect their voice, most singers are really concerned about what's going on with their voice. Okay, and the question, who you were talking about ossification, so long-term use. So if somebody, you know, who knows what's going to happen with our society? I'm so grateful that we live at this point in the world that students, children who know who they truly are being recognized, and that puberty blockers are being used. But it could be that if a child, I don't know how young the children are that we have data on where they would administer testosterone, but it could be that we would see people where if, you know, long-term use of testosterone could lead to early ossification of the laryngeal cartilage, which usually occurs by early 30s. It could be that they might be experiencing that a year or two earlier, but I think definitely if they're taking blockers and then, you know, I think they're going to be happier, not going through puberty as assigned at birth. Okay, and testosterone does change the soft tissue, as I said, the vocal folds, but not the cartilage. So transmasculine singers may have a different timbre, and that's, of course, because of the space within. And so in working with the singing voice, I work with and speaking voice, and I use singing exercises for speaking voice as well as singing voice because they are just so helpful and they can be done in a really simple way. But there are other things that we can do to find the best timbre for a singer, and really whether male or female, that we do a lot of different things. Okay, thank you. Okay. Sandy Hammond, who is my co-author on the third edition chapter, this information that I'm presenting is all from that third edition, which is not out yet. And as I didn't tell you this, Lisa, I was thinking, oh my gosh, you know, am I violating anything of publishing, you know, presenting this ahead of the book coming out? So anyway, but I figure it's her and the chorus's intellectual material. So this is way new data. All right, and this is based on Sandy, who founded and directed the Boston Butterfly Transgender Chorus from September of 2014 until the summer of 2016. She analyzed the data, talking to her singers and learning from them. Trans male singers can vocalize to A2, which is, you want to hit that pitch, please? That was usually their lowest note, an octave and two steps below middle C. Of the 25 singers in the chorus, only two singers were able to vocalize lower. So A4 on the low end. I beg your pardon, A2. Thank you. Thank you. I heard this voice in my ear. All singers reported that they had to learn pitch matching and sight reading, sight singing all over again.
It's actually, this was a huge deal for me. It's because your brain isn't connecting to the larynx. So you think of a pitch in your mind that you want to produce, and then you go to produce it, and your throat produces whatever, how much of a drop you had. So, and it takes a long time. It actually took about 12 years for me to start to pitch match.
Okay. You know, it's such a shock. I mean, of the men that I worked with this morning doing consultations, you know, they were just, I couldn't believe this happened. And when you can sing and you can match pitch and you can count on yourself and you've done all that muscle memory stuff and then boom, we change and it's gone. Holy smokes. So all the men had to learn. I am so sorry to say.
So that's like a guarantee?
It's a guarantee.
I wonder if when you're younger, because your brain development is presumably designed to accommodate pitch change during puberty, and I wonder if people transition earlier, if that's less of an issue than later in life when it's become more that? I don't know, but I'm just wondering.
That's a really good wonder. And what I'm wondering right now, I want to email Alexandros. It's like, okay, you went really slowly. You know, I forgot this part from your dissertation. How much, you know, how much trouble did you have with pitch matching compared to, or even if we look at his subjects, how much trouble did they have compared to the subjects who did the fast versus the low and slow? You know, this is, thank you very much for mentioning that, because it would make sense, because in the research, Alexandros had all the singers, he took every singer in his research through the protocol every day, and breathing and the exercises and the singing, and he made all the decisions on when they could go to the more difficult singing exercises. And I mean, he did a good job. Did a good job.
I'd be curious to know what Eli talks about as well, because he has a blog and talks about testosterone and his experience with it.
Or Mari, who presented earlier today with his voice teacher, or their voice teacher, going through the process of you know, taking lessons before as a mezzo alto, starting testosterone and then documenting the voice change. I don't know if they experienced a similar kind of, you know, pitch dysphoria, basically.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Going through all that, it didn't sound like that was a huge problem, but I do wonder if people who are consistently doing voice work one-on-one as opposed to singing in a chorus, if they have fewer issues.
Yeah, I mean, it's really making sense now that, you know, sometimes, you know that saying about if you want to really learn a subject, teach it. Well, that's what I feel like right now. Whoa, you know, I really want to find out for sure. We have a question, the man in the back.
Yeah, I was wondering, you said that the lowest note was the A2.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any documentation of what the highest note they could reach
with? There's not documentation, no, at least in this chorus. But I can tell you that I worked with a man this morning who had been taking testosterone. I worked with six people. I think he had taken it for 18 months, and he was vocalizing up into the alto range, where, you know, his goal that he asked me to work on with him was to be able to access as many notes as possible across the passaggio and build that transition from chest voice into head voice, get back as much of the head voice as possible. And I was impressed. I mean, we had to stop because of time, but we were up in the middle C octave and he was still rocking, you know, was starting to get a little light.
I think in Constance's article, like, he tracks his own range change, and by the end, I think his top notes were like up at the top of the staff, like F5 or something like that.
And, you know, I can tell you this from working with transfeminine singers, that what we started with could very possibly play a role. Because now this of course was assigned male at birth, but that person had a 4-octave range. So, you know, if we had assigned at birth who transitioned, and that was as a man, has a assigned at birth male, had a 4-octave range. So, you know, who knows how much is lost. I only have one patient that I worked with ever, and I saw her before she realized she was transgender, and she had a lot of voice problems, and so I had filmed her larynx, and I knew what her highest note was, and she came back to see me 2 years later and said, "Anita, I've got something to tell you. I finally figured out why I was trying to speak in such a low voice all the time. I'm trans." And she transitioned. He came back to see me after he had transitioned, and he still had all his top notes. He was not a singer. And we were going, you know, he was going, "I'm so sorry that I can't sing," you know. But he did not lose any range. But he had a lot of allergies, and he went super, super, super slow in how he transitioned.
Anecdotally, I went on low-dose testosterone, and for 4 years, like, my voice dropped in 2 months, and, like, it's still, the bottom is the bottom, it's the same pitch, and I didn't lose my top range at all, and then I had to play around with my dose a couple years ago, and then I lost it. Mm. But for 4 years, it's great. Wow.
Okay, and let me see how we're doing on time here. I think we're still good. Okay, so I've mentioned this. We are essentially training new muscles. And so the way that I work with singers is that, and this is both male and female, and non-binary actually, but if everything that I do is with softer phonation and really easy vocalises, the things I did this morning with different singers, who some who had never sung for, one who hadn't sung for 20 years, who trying to do really, you know, what I call sloppy glissandi, you know, you're just sliding across the pitches. Everything is legato. I work on easy onset just as a way of not hitting those vowels, and I don't think so, you know, I don't think so, that we want to really make it as easy as possible. And, you know, it's boring, but it works. that you don't injure your voice, or you have much less fatigue from doing this. So you're starting in your mid-chest modal speaking voice range. And actually, I've used this with people who couldn't sing, too, just to help them achieve a more pleasant voice quality. So go down the scale by a half a step or a whole step. Ooh. And all right, so decrease. So I work down by a half a step or a whole step, depending on if one feels better for you than the other. But you're just doing this really simple stuff, you know. Ooh. Or just if you know somebody who wants to work on their voice, but they don't sing like I'm assuming most of you do. Ooh. You don't even have to match a pitch on the keyboard. Pick something that's easy for you. Go back and forth smoothly. Then I tell them, just go up a little bit. Because what we want to do is, you know, and what I just did was like if you wanted to work into your passaggio and go up from your modal register. And so for working on your lower register to take your voice lower and strengthening those pitches, you're going down the scale. And you can do the same little simple thing back and forth. Pick any pitch and just roll it back and forth, just softly and gently. And then see if you can think, okay, I'm going to go down a little bit and do that again. You're going to roll a little bit farther. So if I went, just rolling it a little bit, start a little bit lower, roll it back, try it. And the person would gradually go down the scale. When you get to the part where all of a sudden you can hear that your voice quality is different, or it feels like you're pushing, or it's a little too tight, then you reverse. Then you just come up by a pitch. So if you were then you're coming up the scale back up to that middle place. And for women, I do it, you know, going up, and with men who really want to access as much of their higher range as they had before, then I just start it from that mid place going up like that. Come back down to the mid place, go the opposite direction if you want to, come back to the mid place. And so warming up and cooling down, and then afterwards, for sure as a cool down, I will always do some kind of wider range glissandi. And I do tongue tension release exercises, which are hilarious, but they help so much. So Okay, let's go on from there. Okay, there we are. Tongue tension release exercises. If we had 20 minutes extra, I would take you through these because they are such a blast. You're moving your tongue around inside and outside your mouth. Buckle your tongue out. And then the piece de resistance is that we're sticking our tongue right out of our body and right out of our mouth, like, pardon me. And we are trying to talk, keeping our tongue out. And this set of exercises is like so freeing and creates space. If your voice is kind of rough, it will often help to create a clearer tone. But most people, I worked with a really experienced singer who, after she did these exercises, I was just blown away. Her pitch control was like perfect, perfect, perfect. And she had a little bit of trouble with it before we started working. So, and clearer. So I am a big believer. And then the easy onset on vowels, that's kind of a classic singer thing. I do have it on the CD, as well as just some basic vocal warm-ups. But it's the whole thing of putting an H in front of a word that's going to begin with a vowel so that you're not bringing your vocal folds together. And interestingly, some people will have false fold phonation, closure of the ventricular or false vocal folds when they do hard glottal attacks, which is another great reason to not go there. Okay. All right. Interval training schedules. Oh my gosh. The athletes in the room know that an interval training schedule is where you work, whatever that task is athletically, and then you rest. Work, rest, work, rest. And with singers, I started doing this with people who had post-polio syndrome and started using the interval training, and it just blew me away. Their voices got better. So I went on to the speakers and everybody, and people who have been transitioning, whether just a short time or even before they begin, or if they choose not to transition because they don't want to take any medication, find it really helpful because it's like you're doing the work and then you're resting. And I've used intervals as short as 2 seconds of phonation and then 5 seconds of rest, you know, up to 5 minutes of singing at a moderate level and then 3 minutes of rest. I mean, so it's the sort of thing that with anything that's new to your, when you're conditioning muscles, it really can be a fantastic aid in setting up how you're going to safely manage your exercise routine, if you will. Okay, so, yep, and then return to mid-range for cool downs. Okay, all right, remember that the vocal folds could only shorten so much for lower and lowest pitches. Yes?
On your CD, do you go through the tongue release exercises?
I don't, and I decided this morning after we each were consulting with different people, I thought, that's the first video. That's what I want to put on YouTube, is my tongue tension release exercises.
I had a whole bunch of students that I would just send that to.
Oh my gosh. All right. All right. That's, I need that encouragement. Yes. But yeah. You're at St. Olaf.
Yeah. I mean, every student there. It's like, it's a choral problem. They use high air pressure and create resistance back here with the tongue root. So it's all I do in the studio.
All right. Wow. All right. Okay. Well, you know, I'm serious. I did a video of this for the Minnesota Speech and Hearing Association. I did a big long session on voice, and I did these exercises with like 65 people in the room. Everybody paired up. It was just a blast. It was, and everyone was just like, you know, having so much fun with their voice. So, all right. Thank you, Chrisanne. I will. I'm on it.
Do it.
Okay. All right. So, so the vocal folds, they can only get so short, and it's kind of like, okay, the vocal folds are in a V. They're very tiny, as you know. I'm going to let my arms be the vocal folds, and when we go down in pitch, the mass of the vocal folds is still there. It's still the same amount of tissue, but it can't shorten with a smooth edge. So when those vocal folds, which I can't really do, so when those vocal folds come together, the sleeve, if you will, of tissue has not got a smooth edge, and so that's why when we vocalize down, you know, and that should be around maybe A or A flat below C2, yeah, that's okay. Anyway, other than menopause, that's the only thing. It gave me two whole steps on the bottom of my range. And I, whoever said that about, they thought that was very low, about C3 being the average. I think those data are not my 71 years of observation of women, of women talkers. No, that most women cannot vocalize that low. So anyway, I like the idea, but, and I hopefully will have the data someday on more, but I don't think so. So going back to the men here, so both transgender and cisgender men will have a less clear voice quality, which will approach glottal fry, you know, when you go to your very lowest pitches. That rumbling quality created because the vocal folds are so short that they're inside mesial, that should be mesial, not medial, mesial edges cannot meet cleanly and completely when the vocal folds are brought together. There's air escaping because of the incomplete closure and the lax tissue of the vocal folds. Phonation can only be produced at a soft level. And I have worked with cis men with injured voices, as well as trans men with injured voices, who tried to push their voice too low in pitch and who tried to be really loud. Okay. Increased nasality. These are things we can do. And you know, it's so weird. I'll work with breath and nasality. I kind of look at them as being on a continuum because breathiness masks nasality. I'll work with breath with some men and it'll make them sound more masculine. I'll work with breath with some women, it'll make them sound more feminine. I mean, it's just an amazing construct. I mean, there's so many other things that go into what we do to sound feminine or sound masculine. But nasality is one of the things that I experiment with. And Lisa was doing an exercise earlier where she was talking about using the twang and this kind of southern kind of sound, you know. And so these are the vowels, M, N, N, G, V, and Z. Those are ones that can really to help us to get that feeling of buzz going on. And then, of course, a bigger mouth opening helps to improve vocal clarity and audibility. And it also changes resonance. So it's always going to be kind of finding that, I like that phrase, sweet spot, of where everything works together and you feel like, yeah, this is my voice, this is good. Okay. In the last 10 years, maybe even longer than 10 years when I think about it, I've had a number of people as private clients, but also people who have come to me like at the transgender health fair and tell me, I don't want to take hormones because I don't want to change my singing voice. And the way that I look at voice work is that, okay, you get to have it however you want it. One singer that I consulted with this just a few months ago is going to transition, that is her plan, but she is also going to continue performing as a male. And I just said, that's fine. You know, we will work with that and however, whatever you want to do. So there are no limits. The only limits that I feel like we impose are we want it to be healthy for you. Because I did have one woman accidentally, a trans woman, injure her voice, who was so excited. This is the woman with the 4-octave range. And I said, but she didn't use it. I mean, And so I said, okay, interval training, you know, maximum. Well, actually, it was just, this is my recommendation, 15 minutes max, moderate level of loudness. She sang for 45 minutes loud. And we were in the otolaryngologist's office, and I was very worried. And it was just, I mean, it was rad, but at least, you know, no nodules or varices or anything. But, you know, we got to be careful in what we do. So, all right, we have the right to choose. And we can change that. You know, we can change our minds. People have done that, and that's fine. So whether you want a feminine voice, I've had people who wanted to keep people guessing. They didn't want to have a binary gender. And this is like 10 years ago. This was somebody who lectured internationally. And I said, okay, now that I understand what you want, so we can do that, and we end up shaping things kind of based on the individual's goals. Our primary goal, and for teachers of singing and speech and language pathologists, help the singer move toward their goals in a healthy manner. Mm-hmm. And then with stage performers, I've worked with a number of people who are trans who perform, you know, all the stuff that you know about when you perform, microphones, monitors, stage sound levels, the keys the songs are in, the set list, which set comes first, you know, what songs within the set, the arrangements of the songs, those are all things that we have to deal with as musicians. And sometimes I'll ask the singer, you know, well, always I ask what specific qualities, if there's something that they can describe to me, but then who are their favorite artists or spoken word performers or actors or actresses, because sometimes that can help people too. Okay, and then also what they wear, you know, whether they're binding, Lisa mentioned that, but shoes, high heels, all of that.
I need to make a quick announcement.
Okay.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I am Galen, and I'm calling to tell you about a schedule change because of outside. The next session is canceled, unfortunately. And so we are going to go, this session's over at 3, and then make your way directly to the auditorium, and an abbreviated cabaret will start at 3:15, and everything should be done by 4.
So are you saying the concert that was tonight is going to be this afternoon?
Yes. It'll be a shorter version.
I want the whole version personally, but that's...
Some of the performers aren't here, and they're not going to come.
Okay, all right. Okay.
But whoever is here who's performing will do that, and we'll just have an abbreviated show just to wrap it up, since it's getting... It's like getting from bad to worse out there. I just got here. And it was, you know, I mean, you'll live on the way home, but you don't want to wait a lot longer.
How are the roads?
You know, like it's winter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So,
freeways are salted.
I wasn't on the freeway.
Oh.
But on the streets, on the like major roads on the way here. We're like, fine.
Right. Thank you,
Galen. Thanks, Galen. One last thing here that Lisa and I have the same philosophy that, yes, you know, we're the speech and language pathologist, and whoever we're working with is the client or the student or the patient, where, depending on where we work. But we both see the person who comes to see us, that they are also a teacher and we are a student, because there is so much that I learn from the people who come to me that I say, nothing is too minute. Tell me if you notice something, because it might be like a whole nother piece to the puzzle that we'll start figuring out. So, okay. Self-talk, you know, Lisa, I want to check with you because we're really into now our wrap-up time of self-talk. I'll make this very short, that this is about what we say to ourselves in our head. And I meet a lot of perfectionists. I consider myself a recovering perfectionist. I mean, it's a heck of a life to live, really. Perfectionism is not fun. And so how we talk to ourselves can make or break a person's work I mean, certainly in our realm of that we work, but also in life. You know, life is so much better if we can be supportive and encouraging of ourselves. So that's like a whole other piece of the work that I do. Okay. And this is from Katherine Johnson, who is a St. Paul artist. She is cis, but she was born with what's called dysplasia, which means that dysplasia of her hips. They were dislocated, and one foot was dislocated, and one arm, one elbow was dislocated. And she spent 18 months of her life, from 6 months until 2 years, lying face down, bound in a crib and in a children's hospital. And she started, if any of the kids cried, they were given a medicine that essentially made them dissociate from their surroundings. And already she was bound face down. And so she started just vocalizing. I mean, at first she didn't even speak, you know, yet. She started vocalizing to soothe herself and to keep from crying, because she was in this body cast from her shoulders down to her hips that she couldn't breathe when she was in that cast. So she started singing softly, keening really would be what it is, and to soothe herself, and she realized how much it soothed the other children in the ward. And they would all stop gradually, one by one, they'd stop crying or making whatever sounds, and that everyone would go to sleep. And Catherine has endured, I think, 47 surgeries, and she was reading me a libretto that she wrote about her experiences. I was crying, and the next day I said, Catherine, this reminds me of the incredible women and men that I work with and the stories that I have heard about whether binding ourselves as a way of presenting as the gender that we really feel that we know we are, or of making our face a mask, making our body not move very much, keeping ourselves still so as to not call attention to ourselves and not have people call us names or bully us because we don't fit the gender assigned at birth. And I said, with your permission, I want to share this with audiences that I speak to. And so I took this to the United States Professional Association for Transgender Health. Listen, listen. I hear the bloom within the seed. And that's what each of us, whatever our life experiences, we are already blooming inside ourselves. And as far as we have come, we are going to bloom even more. And then she did this painting. Be brave. I am not afraid. I will sing to you a song of beauty, singing light and grace. Be brave. That's what I give to you. That's what this is about. And all the healing power in the world goes to each of you. So, questions?
I think we are going to be running out of here. I think we're just going to not do the singing part just to save on time and get everybody out of here safely. But I would love for you to go away thinking the song, What the World Needs Now is Love.
And I can play it as you leave. You can sing it as you go.
Thank you.